All the way back in September of 2019, we published a video looking at the post-war situation in Latin America, which included a brief rundown of a 1954 CIA-sponsored coup in Guatemala. Almost 3 years later, we decided that taking a deeper look at this coup would help shed light on the future decision-making processes of the CIA, but also help set the stage for future Cold War episodes in Central America, focused around the Cold War proxy wars that erupted there in the 1970s and 1980s. I'm your host, David, and this week we are looking at the 1954 Guatemalan coup. This is the Cold War. My thanks to Squarespace for sponsoring today's video. Squarespace gives people a powerful and beautiful online platform to help create a website for seamless communication with your customers and followers. Use Squarespace to connect with your audience and generate revenue through gated, members-only content. Manage your members, send email communications, and leverage audience insights, all on one easy-to-use platform. Create a community on your Squarespace website that supports threaded comments, replies, and likes, and uses Squarespace's powerful blogging tools to schedule and share posts. And you can even display feedback from your social media profiles right to your website. If you've been thinking about creating a website, either for your personal brand, resume, business, or just for fun, go to squarespace.com/thecoldwar to start your free trial and get 10% off your first purchase. This story begins in the aftermath of the 1944 Guatemalan Revolution against Jorge Ubico's authoritarian regime when Juan José Arévalo, a university philosophy professor, was democratically elected as the president of Guatemala. He was in turn succeeded by his former Minister of Defense, Jacobo Arbenz, who won the 1950 elections, which Arévalo had refused to run in. This was likely a consequence of the 25 coup attempts during his presidency. Now, Arévalo had instituted some reforms that had aimed to help those Guatemalans who were less fortunate and included things like enacting a minimum wage and creating state-run farms for landless peasants. He was eventually forced by labor unions to pass legislation against workplace discrimination and to implement health and safety standards. But that was the extent of Arévalo's reforms, refusing adamantly to make any drastic changes. Arbenz, for his part, however, was willing to make deeper reforms. He had personal ties to members of the Communist Guatemalan Party of Labor, the PGT, a party he legalized during his years in power. After consulting various economists, Arbenz enacted the land reform which Arévalo had so vehemently refused to implement. Known as Decree 900, the bill expropriated all uncultivated land from holdings larger than 673 acres, as well as from estates between 224 and 673 acres, which had less than two-thirds of their land cultivated. By 1954, around 1.4 million acres, some of which once belonged to Arbenz himself, had been redistributed to 500,000 people, a significant step towards dismantling the somewhat feudal Guatemalan economy. Now, while this land reform did provide an economic boost for Guatemala, it disturbed the greatest power and largest landowner in the country, the United Fruit Company. At the time, thanks to deals which had been made with previous Guatemalan regimes, the UFC was really nothing less than a state within a state. It controlled more than 40% of the arable land in the country, it virtually owned Puerto Barrios, Guatemala's main port on the Caribbean Sea, and the UFC's annual profits were double that of the Guatemalan government's revenue. The company was already upset with the previous government legislation that had given the workers the right to strike, and the decree of 1952 was the straw that broke the camel's back. United Fruit lost 234,000 of the 550,000 acres it owned in Guatemala. It was compensated for the loss with a payment of around $630,000. This was the sum that the company itself had in the past claimed this land was worth, but was in reality a significant underestimation that had been made for tax evasion purposes. Now, however, United Fruit was claiming that the land was worth around $60 million. In a bit of a bind, the company decided to leverage some of its close ties to US officials that it had, and UFC lobbied for intervention from Washington. And just what or who were those close ties in the United States? Well, the answer includes, but wasn't limited to, the two Dulles brothers, John Foster Dulles, the US Secretary of State, and Allen Dulles, Director of the CIA. Both had worked in the past with Sullivan & Cromwell, a law firm that represented United Fruit in many of its business deals, with Allen even having served on the firm's board of directors. The brothers clearly had personal reasons to help the company in its time of need. Now, having friends in high places is crucial, but equally important was the misconception among many members of the US government that Guatemala had become a communist nation. This idea was reinforced in the minds of many by Arbenz's reform policies and his personal relationships to leftist organizations. This was, however, despite the fact that the country's economy clearly still followed a capitalist model. With the Cold War intensifying in the early 1950s, the US government became increasingly suspicious of the Guatemalan regime. Following Nicaraguan dictators Anastasio Somoza García's visit to New York in April 1952, the US government began to take steps towards dealing with the communist threat in their backyard. The dictator of Nicaragua had suggested being given weapons to clean up Guatemala himself, a proposal Harry Truman had kindly declined, but one which he subsequently turned over to the CIA, tasking the agency with the same goal. Codenamed Operation PB Fortune, the CIA's plan called for a coup d'etat led by a former Guatemalan army officer, Carlos Castillo Armas, now living in exile in Honduras. The plan also called for the assassination of 58 prominent Guatemalans, as well as the arrest of many others. Armas, who had made a coup attempt back in 1949, would receive help in the form of weapons and $225,000, while also receiving additional funds from the dictators of Venezuela and the Dominican Republic, whom the CIA had contacted and requested assistance in the operation. PB Fortune was given the green light on September 9, 1952, and put into motion soon after, with the CIA using a United Fruit freighter to send confiscated arms to Armas's forces. Not long after, though, with the ship already underway towards Nicaragua, the operation was terminated, with sources citing different reasons for the project's abandonment. However, the premature end of PB Fortune didn't mean the end of US involvement in Guatemalan affairs. In November of 1952, Eisenhower was elected president, a change that substantially shifted US anti-communist policy. Ike was not content with merely containing communism, instead pursuing a policy of actively pushing it back. To this end, he was more than willing to use the CIA to stage coups and replace unwanted and uncooperative regimes with ones which would be friendlier and more sympathetic to US interests. This attitude was reinforced by the successful CIA-orchestrated 1953 Iranian coup, where the democratically elected Prime Minister Mohammad Mossadegh was overthrown and replaced by General Fazlollah Zahedi. So, in August 1953, almost a year after PB Fortune had begun, President Eisenhower gave the green light to the CIA to overthrow Arbenz's government. Now, in contrast to the previous plan, the CIA's new operation, codenamed PB Success, was much, much bigger. The total budget exceeded $5 million, more than 100 agents were employed to bring the plan about, and, just like the first time, lists of assassination targets were created. Like with PB Fortune, PB Success would see the agency work with Castillo Armas and his Army of Liberation to achieve their goal. Although we should point out that other candidates had been considered before his selection. Armas was once again provided with funds and arms to reinforce his band of mercenaries, and they were even given training by CIA instructors at special training camps established in Nicaragua and Honduras. We should note here that, in an effort to intimidate Arbenz, the Central Intelligence Agency did almost nothing to cover up the guerrilla training operations, the logic being to present the downfall of the Guatemalan government as inevitable. This would demoralize the population so they would offer less resistance. Now, providing additional assistance to the CIA and Armas's guerrilla fighters would be a new group of American diplomats sent to Guatemala City in October of 1953 by the State Department and its head, John Foster Dulles. Leading this group was John Purifoy, who assumed his duties as ambassador of the United States to Guatemala in October of 1953. And really, the CIA couldn't have asked for a better man. Purifoy was anti-communist to the bone, and had previous experience working with the agency during his time as US ambassador to Greece, where he had been involved in local post-war politics to such a degree that his name became a byword for any foreigner interfering with Greek politics. By early 1954, tensions between Guatemala and the United States continued to rise, with the US denouncing the Guatemalan government, stating that there was a communist takeover in the country. Guatemala responded in the last days of January, publishing several documents containing information about Operation PB Success that had been leaked by one of Armas's men. This, however, coupled with the forgery of some documents by Guatemalan authorities to reinforce their statement, only helped to unite the US home front against what was now clearly a communist state spreading propaganda. Over the coming months, the United States would manage to isolate Guatemala diplomatically during the Pan American Conference in Caracas, managing to pass a resolution condemning the spread of communism in the Americas. A second, more physical isolation occurred in the following days. In an incident which added fuel to the fire, not that it was really needed, mind you, was that of the Swedish ship Alfheim, transporting Czechoslovakian-made weapons to Guatemala. The discovery of the ship's cargo resulted in an uproar among US officials. This uproar, however, ignored that the purchase was something the Americans had inadvertently caused themselves with the imposition of a weapons ban on Guatemala a few years earlier. This had forced the desperate Central American state to turn to the Eastern Bloc for help. But for the United States, this was a clear message that Soviet influence had spread to the Americas and Guatemala had turned red. The time to strike had come. On June 18, 1954, Castillo Armas joined troops that had entered Guatemala 3 days earlier. They advanced 6 miles into Guatemalan territory and then set up camp, basically unable to move any further. His small band of roughly 500 men could not realistically take on the Guatemalan army and win, yet luckily for him and his US allies, if there was one thing that the CIA was good at, it was psychological warfare. This was the hidden ace that would win the campaign for them. Thousands of leaflets were produced and distributed, while pro-America videos were screened in neighboring friendly countries. At the same time, Guatemalan political leaders started receiving mafia-style death threats, with the CIA sending them coffins and hangman's nooses. But by far the greatest and most influential psychological weapon the CIA employed was a radio station named Voice of Liberation. Airing anti-communist and anti-regime propaganda, its goal was to demoralize citizens, and especially the soldiers of Guatemala, spreading fake or exaggerated news about rebel movements and size of insurgent forces. Now, as a complement to the psychological warfare part of the operation was the bombing of the city of Chiquimula by an F-47 Thunderbolt flown by a mercenary pilot, not an American pilot, as a precaution. The bombing caused chaos briefly, but since the rebel forces failed to make significant gains, the panic faded. Meanwhile, although Armas's ground forces had failed to take Zacapa or Puerto Barrios, the situation in the air was producing results there. The rebel planes, while doing little damage to military installations, had managed to create real fear among the citizens and soldiers in those cities. This fear was multiplied by the Voice of Liberation broadcasts, which assumed the inevitable downfall of the Arbenz government. And not even Arbenz himself was immune to fear, and while he was confident from the outset that Guatemalan forces could beat the insurgents in a head-on fight, he feared the direct intervention of US military forces, or even a war with Honduras if the fighting between the Guatemalan loyalists and rebels took place too close to the Honduran border. He attempted to solve the issue through diplomatic means, appealing to the UN Security Council to initiate an investigation. As you might have guessed, however, this type of attempt was destined to fail since the United States simply vetoed it. Only a few days later, on the 25th of June, the Guatemalan army was beaten, not by force of arms, but by fear and low morale. The army simply refused to fight. The officers at Zacapa, convinced that a fight against a foe backed by the US was futile, sent a message to Arbenz asking for the president's resignation. They even threatened to switch to the rebel side in the event he didn't resign. Arbenz decided to make a last-ditch effort to defend his country by arming the civilian population. What he found, though, was that the civilians were just as intimidated by the prospect of fighting against the US, as well as their own army, and only a few hundred showed up to fight. Seeing this, Colonel Diaz and a few other senior Guatemalan officers realized the end had come and plotted to overthrow Arbenz. It was at this time that Purifoy became the man of the hour, as he reassured the plotters that he could negotiate a truce as long as Arbenz abdicated. Finally accepting defeat, Arbenz agreed to resign on the 27th of June and left the presidential palace, seeking political asylum at the Mexican embassy, leaving behind a taped speech which was later broadcast, explaining that he resigned in order to eliminate any pretext for the invasion and to preserve the gains of the October Revolution of 1944. Following Arbenz's resignation, Colonel Diaz was quick to step in and announce that he was taking over the country, forming a three-man junta together with Colonels El Fego Hernán Monzón Aguirre and José Ángel Sánchez, and that they would continue to fight against Armas. Diaz's plan fell short, however, as Monzón overthrew him with a coup of his own soon after. Monzón was also unwilling to share power with Armas until the Americans and Purifoy intervened and asked the dictator of El Salvador, Oscar Osorio, to host negotiations between them. Finally, on the 2nd of July, an agreement was reached by which Armas and his subordinate, Major Enrique Trinidad Oliva, joined Monzón in a five-man junta. The other two colonels were Monzón's supporters, basically guaranteeing Monzón's presidency. Unfortunately for Monzón, and unbeknownst to him, the colonels had made a secret pact to resign a few days later, in exchange for $100,000 each, we might add. On the 7th of July, they followed up on their promise, and Monzón was left outnumbered, forcing him to resign, leaving Armas to be elected the president of the junta. 6 days later, his government was officially recognized by the United States. In what we are all sure were totally free, fair, and not at all rigged elections held in October of 1954, Armas won a staggering 99% of the vote, solidifying and legitimizing his place in power. In the aftermath of Operation PB's success, the CIA launched a new project, Operation PB History, an effort to locate and analyze documents belonging to the Arbenz administration, which would prove the connection between Guatemalan communists and the Soviet Union, therefore justifying the coup. Despite pouring many resources into the project, the operation failed to provide any solid proof of the US claims. Not the last time the US government would have this issue. The long-term consequences of the coup were felt only a few years later, as the abolishment of many of the democratic freedoms Guatemala had achieved from the 1944 revolution led to leftist insurgencies starting in 1960, ultimately plunging the country into a 36-year-long civil war and helping to destabilize the entire region. We hope you've enjoyed today's episode, and to make sure you don't miss all of our future episodes, please make sure you subscribe to our channel and have created a pirate radio station which broadcasts only pro-bell button messages, singing the glorious praises of the button. I would like to take this opportunity to thank all of our supporters, and if you aren't a patron, please consider supporting us at patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com. This is the Cold War Channel, and as we think about the Cold War, I will leave you with the words of JFK. In the final analysis, our most basic common link is that we all inhabit this small planet. We all breathe the same air, we all cherish our children's future, and we are all mortal.